At our church, Jesus is Lord. That single belief calls us together as a community and sends us into our world with hope and purpose. At our church, your past will never define your future. There's always redemption, which means there's always a brighter day. At our church, we don't think we're better than any other church out there. We're just doing our best to become our best. At our church, we want you to believe in God, but we also want you to know that God believes in you. We are not against people who don't attend church anywhere. Instead, we pursue them with love, the very same love that's pursuing us. At our church, we're learning to serve God with all our hearts, and we're learning to worship Him with all our lives. And if you're looking for the perfect church, we're not it. At our church, we will make mistakes, but we will choose to grow from them. At our church, we're part of a global community that's knit together by the resurrection of Jesus. And by the way, at our church, we believe that really happened too. At our church, we will engage with people who are in real need because we are the hands and the feet of Christ. And finally, we need you to hear this loud and clear. At our church, it's not really our church at all. It's His. And we live and move and breathe in His church for His glory and His fame, not ours. So here's the invitation. You're invited to jump in with your whole heart at your own pace and to experience the life that awaits you in Christ. Friends, this is going to be good. Welcome to our church.
At Victorious Believers Ministries, we are committed to sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ by focusing on family, missions, evangelism, discipleship, and community development. During this last year, we have found new innovative ways to reach the lost during a time when so many people have felt forsaken or forgotten. Our VBM life groups are helping people build relationships and gain educational, emotional, and spiritual tools to live the victorious life. With dynamic, cutting-edge programming like Grief Share and Divorce Care, along with groups that target special interests like health and fitness, support for life for those 55 and up, personal finance, crafts and gardening, Sunday school, and much more, we are creating a thriving church culture where families and individuals of all ages and at all stages in life can grow and maximize their God-given potential. Our Pray and Go ministry is leaving small reminders of God's love at people's homes when they need it the most. Our children are exploring Bible stories in STEM as they engage together during their weekly safe playtime. Our Helps ministry is preparing for the opening of our local community pantry to provide families in need with food and supplies. Our Monday night prayer services are booming and reaching people across the world each week. The VBM family extends way beyond the walls of the church and the names on the membership roster. We are a global church assigned to a local community. That means that we continue to serve our neighbors while also sowing into missions efforts abroad. It also means that through technology, we are able to consistently offer biblically sound teaching and programming so that you and your family can continue to grow in your relationship with God. And still provide the opportunity for those out of state to become members of our VBM communities, which is the newest way to enjoy VBM as your church home away from home. We have seized the opportunity to do ministry in a new way. We are growing. We are expanding. We are walking in kingdom dominion. We could have given up. We could have become discouraged. But that's not what eagles do. Eagles soar. During a storm, they choose to stand out and rise. We are continuing to live the victorious life and to strive to touch the lives of others both in our local community and around the world. Today, we celebrate all that God has done, is doing, and will continue to do at VBM and within the body of Christ at large. Thank you for being a part of our VBM family.
Hi, I'm Pastor Chris.
And I'm Lady Kenyatta Pryor of Victorious Believers Ministries in Saginaw, Michigan.
We're excited to have the opportunity to share what God continues to do in our ministry. We believe that family is so important, And being a part of family helps each and every one of us grow.
What are you waiting on?
We love to have you be a part of the VBM community, you and your family.
And always remember to join the victorious life.
Victorious believers, and we stand,
and we stand.
That is who you are. Hallelujah. Come on, lift your hands. Oh, you a way maker, miracle worker. You a promise keeper. You're the light in the darkness. The light in the darkness. I worship.
in the darkness. Yes. He's our miracle worker.
Uh-huh.
We can still call on the name of the Lord.
Yes,
we can call on him, oh God.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Come on and put your hands together. Glory. Yes. Hallelujah.
Oh,
Before I pray, I just want to share something really quick. This week I was going on a walk with a wonderful friend of mine, and we were just discussing the things of God, and he said he believes that there's victory coming through Christ. And the moment he said that, something dawned on me, and I looked at him and said, you know, what you said is really wrong, because according to the Bible, the victory has already been given. So before I pray, I just really want to read this scripture, because it's been on my heart all week as I mentioned it to him. And then it's John 19:28, and I'm reading to 30. After this, Jesus, knowing that all was finished, said to fulfill the scripture, "I thirst." A jar full of sour wine stood there, and they put a sponge full of sour wine on a hyssop branch and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, "It is finished." And he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. So I truly believe that when Jesus said it is finished, he didn't miss words. He was very specific. He knew what he was saying. So all we have to do is to claim the victory in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, with that, let's go into prayer. Father, we thank you, we bless you, we give you all glory, honor, and praise this morning. There is none like you. You've been our God before the earth, and you will continue to be God, even to the end of time, beyond the end of time. You are holy, you are righteous. You are God, and there is none before you, and there is none after you. You are the King of glory, the Almighty God, the Prince of Peace, the Lord of Lords, the Ancient of Days, the Rock of Ages, the Healer, the Redeemer, the Provider. You are God all by yourself. Lord, we exalt your name this morning. We enthrone you in our lives. Father, we come to worship you not because of what you've done. We worship you because of who you are. God, you are great, and you are greater. You are greater than coronavirus. You are greater than poverty. You are greater, Father, than war. You are greater than any situation that we will ever face, that we are facing, that has ever come to our lives. Father, we come before you because we are so confident of who you are, that we are just standing in your presence and basking in your glory, and knowing that, God, that glory, that victory that you have promised, that, Lord, we receive it today in Jesus' name. Lord, we know we've sinned. We know we've turned our backs on you so many times. We know there are things that we've done that have not been, Father, pleasing to you. But Lord, we stand and we also know that Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary paid it all for us. And so we trust that that payment is more than enough to cover our sins and give us access to your spirit. So Holy Spirit, we come and we ask you to take control right now. Take over in Jesus' name right now. Every single person, every single soul, every single person that is in need of your presence, Holy Spirit, begin to, Father, take over, fulfill us. When you said, when the Spirit of the Lord, when you are with us, Lord, we experience peace. We experience joy. We experience love. And so, Lord, wherever these three things are absent, Lord, in Jesus' name, I declare right now that they will be experienced by every single person that can hear me right now, that they will experience peace, love, and joy, regardless of their situation. God, these three things the Holy Spirit brings, and he brings us right now. So we receive it, and Father, we swim in your peace, we swim in your love and your joy in Jesus' name. Lord, and we pray that there are people, Father, that are listening to us in the hospital, but that are stricken with infirmity, with all kinds of sicknesses, we don't know. But we know that you are a healer. And so, Holy Spirit, when you visit, we ask that you bring healing in Jesus' name. There are people, Father, listening right now, that are going through serious financial situations. Their rent, their mortgage, whatever they have, bills, that they even where the next meal is coming from. But Lord, we know you are the great provider. You are the God that rained manna from heaven in the wilderness for 40 years. How much more what you can do for us? God, we trust that you can provide. And so we are trusting in your provision right now in Jesus' name. Father, there are people stricken with fear. We don't know where that fear is coming from. Fear of the unknown, fear of principalities, fear of powers. But you said in your word
that you have given us authority. And so we hold on to that authority right now, and then we ask Jesus that you be our protector, that you prevent any form of attacks that are coming into our homes. We cancel it in Jesus' name. Your word said they will come against us one way, but they will flee in seven other ways. So we are praying right now that every attack on your church, on any believer that is hearing this right now, Father, be returned in Jesus' name. The Holy Spirit, you begin to take over. Just take over. Father, we pray for VBM. We pray that as this church is named Victorious, that victory will be our signature. That victory will be our identity. That victory will be in our DNA. That anything that anybody here is pursuing, Father, regardless of what it is, whether it's any application school, anything that anybody here is seeking, pursuing, or looking for, that you grant them victory in Jesus' name. Because that is what you've named this nation. That's what you've named this church. Lord, we pray for victory for every person here. Over any challenge that is coming, we ask for victory. And Lord, we continue to pray that you bless the shepherd and the first family of this house, that you bless every single person here, that you bless the message today, that as it comes, that it will begin to change, transform lives in Jesus' name. Lord, we are so grateful that you call us your own, you call us your children, that you love us so much, that you stand and you defend us in all situations, that you would even give up your son to die for us, and that you will give us the victory through it all. We thank you for healing in the mind, healing in the heart, healing in the body. We thank you for all that you are doing for your children, and then we continue to praise you and grateful for it. In Jesus Christ's name we pray, amen.
Well, praise the Lord, saints. Praise the Lord, saints. Psalm 47 and 1. Oh, clap your hands, all ye people. Shout unto God with a voice of triumph. Let me say it again. Oh, clap your hands, all ye people. Shout unto God with a voice of triumph. Shout unto God with a voice of praise. Hey, praise the name of the Lord. If you're glad to be here on this morning, let's stand on our feet one time and give God some praise. Let's stand on our feet and give God some praise. Yeah. Everybody's watching the Olympics right now, and we're going to USA. But let's give some praise to Jesus. Hallelujah, the author and the finisher of our faith. He's the lover of our soul. He's the source of our strength. I don't know about you, but he's the strength of my life. I am nothing without him. We thank God for him on this morning. Thank God for the blood that he shed on Calvary's cross. Amen. Hallelujah, Jesus. Glory to your name. Worthy is the Lamb of God. Father, we give you praise in this place. Have your way in this place on this morning. Move by your spirit in this place. Save on today. Heal on today. Deliver on today. Praise the name of the Lord. You're able. God, you're more than able. Hallelujah. We look to the hills from which cometh our help, knowing that all of our help comes from the Lord. If God's done anything for you, you ought to praise him on today. Did he wake you up this morning? Did he start you on your way? Gave you a mind to get up and come to church on this morning? Gave you a mind to get up and look at the service virtually on this morning? Ain't God good? God is good all the time, and all the time God is good. Won't he do it? Every time. Praise the name of the Lord. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord on today. Well, we thank God for another church-going opportunity on this morning. Praise the name of the Lord. Today is welcome back to in-person service on today. Praise the name of the Lord. Let's give God some praise. We were able to come to the house of the Lord on today. Amen. We're comfortable in here. We're social distance. We have our mask on, but we're here to hear the word of the Lord. Amen. We're here to give God some praise on today. Well, our pastor is not in service on this morning. He is resting. So I want you to be praying for him and his family. He's also celebrating his 25th year wedding anniversary. Hallelujah. Let's give God some praise for that. He and Lady K, great examples of what marriage looks like. The Pryor family, they're great examples of what a family should look like. Amen. It's not all about church. It's about spending time with your family as well, making memories. Praise the name of the Lord. Amen. So God is good on this morning. Those that are virtually with us, we thank God for you. I know that we have viewers all over the world, amen, even Africa, that tunes in to our services. So we thank God for you joining us on this morning. You could have been looking at any service on this morning, and those visitors that are here with us as well, you could have visited any other church, but you chose to fellowship with us on this morning. So we don't take that for granted. Amen. And we thank and praise God for each one of you that are here, those that are virtually as well. Well, my assignment is to get up this morning and do the offerings. It's offering time. Hallelujah. Let's give God some praise. We get excited about giving our tithes and offerings in this place because we know that God, He always blesses, amen, a cheerful giver, amen. So I just want to read Malachi 3, verses 8 through 12. It says, will a man rob God? Yet he have robbed me. But ye say, wherein have he robbed thee? In tithes and offerings. Verse number 9, you are cursed with a curse, for you have robbed me and this whole nation. Verse number 10, bring ye all the tithes to the storehouse, that there may be meat in my house. And prove me now wherewith, says the Lord of hosts, if I would not open the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive. And I will rebuke the devourer for your sakes, and he shall not destroy the fruits of your ground. Neither shall your vine cast her fruit before the time in the field, said the Lord of hosts. And all nations shall call you blessed, for you shall be a delightsome land, says the Lord of hosts. Amen. So we know that when we give our tithes and when we give our offerings, not only do we get blessed, but the ministry gets blessed as well. Amen. We know that the lights have to be paid, electricity, and all of the other things that it takes to run this church. Amen. And so your tithes and your offerings will help to contribute to those things. Amen. And as a board of directors, one of the members of the board of directors, we oversee the financial fiduciary responsibilities here at Victorious Believers Ministries. And I can tell you, we account for every dime. Amen. It is spent wisely. So I thank God for the board of directors and their responsibility to the church. Amen. Before we do the offering, we're going to do our believer's confession. If you would do it with me, we're going to say it together. Dear Lord, thank you that the same power that raised you from the dead lives inside of me. Because of this, I know that I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. I pray that today I'll be surrounded by your favor, that no weapon formed against me will prosper. Thank you for going ahead of me and making the crooked places straight and the rough places smooth. Father, open doors of opportunity for me that no man can shut. I thank you in advance that my life will be blessed so that I can be a greater blessing to others. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing to you today. And we always say in this place, there should be no lack in this house. There should be no lack in my house. There should be an abundance in this house. There should be an abundance in my house. Amen. So there's six ways to give. Amen. Those are on the screen. If you're here in the sanctuary and you have an offering, you can hold it up and the deacons will come around and they will pick up your offering. Let's pray over this offering even on today. Father, we thank you for an opportunity to sow into the kingdom on today, Father. We know, God, that, oh God, as we sow, Father, we shall reap a harvest, oh God. And we just thank you for all of your manifold blessings. Thank you for supplying all of our needs according to your riches in glory, God. in the name of Jesus. We ask you to bless some 30, some 60, and some even 100-fold on today. We give you praise, we give you honor and glory. In Jesus' name, thank God. Amen. Well, at this time, we are going to have our announcements. So take a look at the screen and see the announcements at this time. God bless.
Come on, make some noise for Jesus. The Bible says in Romans 8 and 37, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us.
Hello and God bless you, Victorious Believers Ministries. These are your church announcements and VBM upcoming events. To all of our guests, friends, and family, Pastor Chris, First Lady Kenyatta, and Co-Founder Evangelist Ruth C. Pryor, along with the entire VBM Nation, want you to know how very humbled and grateful we are for you choosing to worship with us. We pray you are blessed by our service. Sunday, August 1st, VBM is officially reopening its doors for in-person service. It's been over a year and a half since we have been able to worship together in full force. Rest assured that our staff and leaders are prepared to assist in helping to ensure that you return to a safe but engaging worship environment. Mask and social distancing will still be required. Holy Communion will be observed immediately following services. Not able to worship with us in person? No worries. VBM communities are the new way that you can remain connected to the ministry, grow spiritually, and participate in leadership opportunities here at the ministry, regardless of your geographic location. Your home away from home. Our services, life groups, and children's ministry will remain virtual, which means that if you are a part of our online campus, you are an important part of our family, and we want to make sure that you never have to miss any of the ministry events, updates, or an opportunity to engage with others on our Christian journey. If you're interested in more information about how to join VBM communities, email info@victoriousbelievers.com. Hey, it's time to meet up and check in. All young adults ages 18 through 24 are invited to join the Ignite Young Adult Ministry for a night of fun and fellowship on Friday, August 6th at 7 p.m. at Friday Night Live at Morley Plaza in Saginaw. Mark your calendars for the Michigan Southwest No. 3 36th Annual Holy Convocation. This hybrid event will include both virtual and in-person services beginning Wednesday, August 11th through Friday, August 13th. The official registration fee is $25, and personal attendance for our Thursday and Friday evening in-person services will also require registration. To register, visit our jurisdictional website at www.sw3micogic.org/holy-convocation. The convocation will begin with a virtual service Wednesday, August 11th, starting with prayer at 7 p.m. Eastern Time, with the evening service beginning promptly at 7:30 p.m. Eastern, with that evening's guest speaker, Bishop Edwin Walker of the Northern Illinois jurisdiction and pastor of the Friendly Temple Church of God in Christ in Chicago, Illinois. All remaining services and events for the week will be in person and include the Woman's Day Luncheon, Thursday, August 12th at 11 a.m., with Southwest No. 3's very own elect lady, Evangelist Dorothy L. Duncan. Then join us for that evening service at 7 p.m. with the speaker of that evening, Southwest No. 3's Supervisor of Women Designate, Mother Alethea Nichols Taylor. On Friday, August 13th at 11 a.m., join us for the Missions Army Brunch, hosted by Administrative Assistant Pastor Terrence Lachey, Southwest No. 3's Mission President. Then come back at 7 p.m. that evening and join us for our official night with our jurisdictional prelate and anointed servant leader, Bishop Samuel Duncan Jr. My friends, this is an event you do not want to miss. That's the Southwest No. 3's 36th Annual Holy Convocation and Events, Wednesday, August 11th through Friday, August 13th. We look forward to seeing you there. And join us for the 4th Annual Victorious Life Family Conference, August 18th through the 22nd, with this year's theme, SAFE, Strengthening All Families Effectively. You can't steal home. 5 power-packed days of fun and education for the entire family. Special guests this year include Bishop Linwood Dillard, Pastor Herb Ford, Pastor Corey Pryor, Ebony Gibson, Kai Gritter, along with the Boy Scouts of America, Girl Scouts Heart of Michigan, local banks, and other community partners. On Saturday, August 21st, we will host our 13th annual back-to-school rally and provide hundreds of book bags and school supplies to families in need, plus games, prizes, and fun activities for the entire family. Food trucks will also be available. Registration is free. You must register to attend in-person services and or the empowerment workshops. To be a vendor at this year's conference, email info@victoriousbelievers.com for more information. There's still time for you to save on your consumers' energy bills. We need more families to sign up for a home evaluation for free energy efficient upgrades. The evaluations can be done in person or virtually. When you participate in this effort, you will help the ministry receive free funds through a rewards program that will help enable us to continue to do the work of the ministry and so into missions. To sign up, simply text CONSUMERS to 989-656-1975. Please help us reach our goal. Remember, you can download the VBM Church app and stay tuned to all events, updates, weekly announcements, as well as download sermon notes and much, much more. Now, for a repeat of our announcements, or if you have questions regarding any of the events mentioned, simply visit our website at www.victoriousbelievers.com for a complete listing of upcoming events and services, or call the church office at 989-755-7692. Finally, remember, you can always follow us on social media. Check us out, follow us, and like us, because we absolutely, positively love you. Well, I certainly hope you found our announcements both informative and enjoyable. And remember, here at Victorious Believers Ministries, our mission is to passionately seek God, joyfully serve others, and intentionally love people. I'm Elder Tom Harvey, your church announcer, wishing you and yours a wonderful, safe, and prosperous week. Until next time, may God bless you real good.
Again.
Hallelujah. Now, people might not know about that choir master, Ricky Dillard. One more time. How we used to say it?
Well, I remember growing up, I would hear the church mothers say something like this. I'm glad to be in the service. I'm glad to be in the service. I'm glad to be in the service. One more time.
Yeah.
I'm glad to be in the service.
Yeah.
I'm glad to be in the service. I'm glad to be in the service. One more time. Let me say it again. I'm glad to be in the service.
Woo!
I'm glad to be in the service.
Yeah.
I'm glad to be in the service one more time. I'm glad to be in the service. I'm glad to be in the service. I'm glad to be in the service one more time.
Make me feel all good all up in here. Yes, we're glad to be in the service. Now, we appreciated the virtual services and the technology that allowed us and our pastor and leaders who made it possible, but it ain't nothing like being in the house of the Lord.
Yes, woo! I am so glad to be in the house of the Lord one more time.
One more time. See, right about now, if I was at home, I might be frying up a little egg, like so like that, yes. I might be cooking some bacon and listening in to what's going on. Sometimes you get a little distracted, but it's nothing like being in the presence of the Lord. And one thing I really got excited about this week.
And what was that?
I didn't have to RSVP. Hey, hey, not even. A little bit.
You didn't even have to check in with Sister Barb.
No, ain't that right, Sister Barb? I didn't have to RSVP. I could just show up. My family and friends could come. And that was a blessing all by yourself.
Yes.
Now, I got so excited this morning, I didn't know what to put on. I said, Lord, we're going back into the house. I've been wearing my robe and my little pajamas and leisure outfit. I don't know what to put on this morning to worship the Lord.
Now, I was wondering myself, because I saw you all fixed up.
Yeah.
And I was thinking that you probably would have had on a little kitten heel, but you actually got your little heel on this morning. Mm. You just ready to praise the Lord and get your dance on.
Yeah, and I know it ain't all about my dress, but I just wanted to feel good again. I just have been in a little slump. Had gained a little COVID weight and pandemic weight, and I wanted to be a little jazzy this morning. Hallelujah.
All right.
Yes. I put a little sparkle in my worship. See that little sparkle.
Oh, I see you've been shopping.
Oh, yeah. I was online. It was so much time at home. I was shopping. I went to this little boutique, though, in Birch Run. It's called Tasha de la Vera. And I got everything that I needed to come in and worship this morning. They had everything. They had everything I needed, and I was ready this morning.
Okay, now, wait a minute. Now, that explains it, because you've been shopping.
Mm-hmm.
And so you couldn't decide what you wanted to put on, apparently, because you got on all these necklaces, got your lace gloves on.
Hallelujah.
You got all these accessories on. What's going on with these accessories? And wait a minute. Yeah, you've been shopping. You still got the tag on your bag and everything.
Lord, I was moving so fast, and I wanted to represent the blood this morning. So I threw on a splash of red. But it ain't even all about that. Just come and worship the Lord. It don't matter what you got on. This was just my personal choice. So what are you excited about?
I am excited, like I said, to be in the house of the Lord just one more time.
Yes.
That's exciting enough.
Yes. And what else?
Well, okay, let me be honest. I'm glad to be here, but I can't wait until service is over so I can greet the people. I'm ready to hug on some people and show some love.
Whoa. No. We here, but we ain't doing all that. Now, don't you go out in that narthex hugging people. Now, we're back here in the sanctuary, but we still yet following COVID protocols. Hallelujah. You see how the people spread out, the family sitting together? Look at them Watsons. They sitting together. Oh, the Browns over there. We still spaced out. We still got on our masks. Well, the only reason I'm standing next to you this close is because we hang out all the time anyway. So we in the same inner circle. So that's fine. But you see how everybody spread out? So you go in the narthex and you do this. Don't be grabbing on nobody and don't be touching, because you know what? I got a revelation.
And what was that?
The Bible forewarned us of social distancing.
Wait a minute.
Mm-hmm.
The Bible forewarned us. What do you mean?
It said in Psalms, touch not my anointed, and do prophets, deacons, sisters, mothers, you know, all in them. Do them, no harm. It was telling us, don't touch nobody, because we don't want to harm them. That's the word of the Lord.
Okay, so you've been in the word during the pandemic, but I'm going to need you to go deep in your prayer closet, because you know that is not what the word was saying.
Well, okay, I might have been in my clothes closet, but I'm going to go back. But that's the word that I got. But we're just so glad that everybody here, we want to say welcome back. And how does it go?
Welcome back, welcome back, welcome back.
Glad to see
welcome
you here.
Welcome back, welcome back, welcome back.
I seen the Marie.
Welcome back. Welcome back, welcome back.
Look at your sister Holly.
Welcome back, welcome back, welcome back.
All right, Mother Otilia.
Welcome back, welcome back, welcome back.
To everybody,
we
want to
say,
welcome back.
Well, praise the Lord, everybody. Amen. Well, welcome back. Let's say amen for our Fine Arts Ministry, Sister Tasha Parker and Sister Fontella Smith. It's all right to laugh, ain't it? It's all right. The Bible says, laugh to do it the heart good like a medicine. But I have stood today with this task to bring forth the speaker. It's so good to be in the house of the Lord one more time. It's great to be back in fellowship with my brothers and sisters in Christ. The praise team has went forth. We have sung songs, but now is the time when we hear what the Lord has to say to us. And we are so blessed today to be in the hands of our co-founder. Amen. Let's clap our hands for Evangelist Ruth C. Pryor. Amen. She is a mother. She is a phenomenal speaker in the body of Christ. There are so many things I could say about this woman. She was a mother to us all. She is a trailblazer. She is a great example for women everywhere. She is an encourager. It's not a moment that I haven't seen her trying to encourage someone that has experienced death or just encouraging by words. Amen. This woman has done so much for so many people. The Bible says the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. There's no gender there, man or woman. Her steps are being ordered by God. Amen. She was the wife of the late Bishop Marvin C. Pryor, and she stood by his side faithfully, supporting, praying for him, always being there. Amen. Let's get ready to hear what God has to say. What a way to come back to church and be in the hands of Evangelist Ruth C. Pryor. I ask that you would stand to your feet and receive this great woman of God as she prepares to come forth. Amen. Clap your hands and receive her as she comes at this time. Come on, everybody say, God bless Evangelist Ruth C. Pryor.
Oh, come on, clap your hands for Jesus. Act like you love him. Give him an applause. Clap your hands for Jesus. What a mighty God we serve. Come on, clap your hands for Jesus. Oh my, he spared us to see another day. He's a good God. He's a faithful God. He's a loving God. After that wonderful welcome back to church and those wonderful comedians, those wonderful saints, we just thoroughly enjoyed that presentation today. I praise God for being here today. I do give honor and respect to the Spirit of the Lord and to our pastor and first lady and to all of our ministers and deacons. What a joy, what a privilege it is to be in the house of the Lord one more time. Well, I'm praying, standing in this spot. You know, when you don't do it often, sometimes it goes somewhere and sit down. But I'm trusting God today that you will be blessed by what the Spirit has spoken to me. I've enjoyed everything. It's been wonderful, the praise team. The prayers that were prayed, God is just so faithful, and I love him with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength. He's a good God. Don't you agree? Father, if you would just bow your heads with me for a moment of prayer. Father, I thank you for your love, for your kindness, and I come in the name of Jesus, your darling son, who paid such an awesome price. The sacrifice was great, and so I thank you. I thank you for the Holy Ghost that lives inside of me. What a good God you are. You are amazing. Yes, you are. You are amazing. You are incredible. You are wonderful. You are loving. You're kind. You're faithful, and you too. And so I thank you for all you've done, what you're going to do. Even on today, we ask that you would save, heal, deliver, and set free. Hallelujah. We praise you, for thou art worthy of honor and glory and praise. If anybody deserves praise, hallelujah, it's you, God. You deserve it. Oh, yes, you deserve it. What a wonder you are. What a wonder you are. So have your way today. Have your way today. Have your way today. Encourage, lift in the name. Encourage, bow down heads in the name. Bind up the brokenhearted and set the captives free. So we give you glory, we give you honor, and we give you praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. From the book of Psalms, Psalms 119 and 165, it says this: great peace have they which love thy law, and nothing shall offend them. Philippians 4, 6 through 7 reads, be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Jesus Christ. Praise the Lord. When peace, like a river, attendeth my way. You can be seated. When sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul. The day when the faith shall be sight, the cloud be rolled back as a scroll, the trump shall resound, and the Lord shall descend a song in the night. Oh, my soul, it is well with my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well. Oh, hallelujah. It is well. 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 The name of the Lord. Oh yes, it is well. It's well with my soul. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. This morning, I trust that God has given me something to encourage you, because we are living in such trying times. All of us are experiencing all kinds of things, and it seems that the world is going to hell with breakneck speed. You name it, it's happening. If you can think of it, it's happening. And in recent months, our pastor has been teaching this series on warfare, from trauma to triumph. And everyone, no doubt, will experience some form of trauma in life. But it's how each person chooses or decides to deal with that circumstances that will greatly impact the rest of your life. If you're taking in these messages, if you're listening to these messages, I trust that they will be a blessing to you as they have been to me. You know, saints, life can be so unpredictable and challenging. And there are joys and sorrows. There are beautiful blessings and distressful difficulties which come so unexpectedly. Out of nowhere, they just show up. Our life dreams and our plans are changed in an instant. But with faith in a loving God and trust in His divine help, we can confidently say, it is well. It is well with my soul. Horatio Spafford knew something about life's unexpected challenges. He was a successful attorney and real estate investor who lost a fortune in the Great Fire of Chicago in 1871. Around the same time, his beloved four-year-old son died of scarlet fever. Thinking that a vacation to England on a ship would really benefit them, planning to go later, come along after his wife and children, he put them on a ship that crossed the Atlantic Ocean. But that ship was involved in a terrible, terrible collision and sunk. More than 200 people lost their lives, including all four of Horatio's precious daughters. However, his wife did survive. He immediately set out for England. And as they approached that spot where that shipwreck occurred, he thought about his daughters. Then words of comfort and hope filled his heart. They filled his mind as he thought about his loving daughters. Four-year-old son gone, fortunes gone, and now the loss of his four daughters. The words of comfort filled his heart and his mind. From this devastating experience, he penned these words to this beloved hymn that we sing oftentimes at funerals. But I trust that you can say it today. It is well. It is well. Because we experience all kinds of losses, where it's a loss of a family member, a job, some career you thought you had dreamed about. We lose our homes, we lose material possessions, but can you still say, it is well? Today I want to talk to you about peace through trauma. Peace through trauma. I would like to once again share my story, because I've learned that healing from trauma begins with the courageous act of telling your story. I share it his, and we could go on. The Bible is full of all stories of all kind of heroes and famous people and prophets and missionaries who had trauma stories. But I'm aware today that many of you here have heard my story, And I trust that maybe some of you watching streaming have heard it also. But I want you to listen. Because from the series that the pastor has taught, sometimes we think that nothing ever happens to anybody but me. The devil feeds us that you're the only one going through. But as I told you, healing comes through sharing your story. And because our world is experiencing a worldwide pandemic, it has caused an overwhelming amount of grief and trauma. Dr. David Jeremiah says, we're living in a weeping world. People are weeping all over the world because of loss, because of hurt. And so today I want to talk to you about peace through trauma. Now I'm really thankful for the peace that God has so graciously given me, but I say to God be the glory for all of it. In 2010, my beloved husband of 46 and a half years transitioned to heaven after returning home from a six-day mission trip to Africa. He was only home 2 hours before he suddenly slipped away. My family was devastated. The love of my life gone without a warning, without a goodbye. Gone. My loving husband, the father of my children, my pastor, our bishop, my best friend, my constant traveling partner, gone, G-O-N-E, gone. It was indescribable pain, excruciating pain. But you know what? There was no feeling of shame because I know sometimes when you lose something, the psychologist said there's a certain amount of pain, a shame that comes along with it. But there was no shame for me. There was no guilt. Neither was there any anger. But oh, so much anxiety. Lord! How do I go on without my loving husband? Satan tried to torment my mind and fill me with doubt. The sleepless nights, the loneliness, the drive home alone. Our every Friday evening dinner date nights. Gone. Gone. The pain was so intense that at times I felt that maybe, just maybe, it would have been better not to have ever known such love and happiness. Where do I go when I need someone to talk to? Who do I turn to when nobody is there to listen? And who can I lean on when there's no foundation stable? Trauma, 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 trauma. But peace through trauma. And little did I know that 7 years later, in 2017, I would experience that intense pain and sorrow again in the loss of my second oldest son, Mel Pryor. There are no words to describe how it feels to lose a child. But God. I heard somebody say, but God. Peace through trauma. I want that to resonate in your spirit. Peace through trauma. The word peace is mentioned over 420 times in the Bible. So what exactly is peace? We often think of peace as the absence of fighting and chaos, no struggle, no stress. But peace is more than holding up a peace sign. Peace is more than wearing a t-shirt with a symbol on the front. But real peace is what Jesus gave us. Jesus gave us peace as a gift to in the midst of stormy situations. Peace in the midst of a deep trial. Treat peace in the courtroom when it looks like everything is stacked against you. Peace. You remember when the disciples were out on that boat in that storm, on that raging sea? Hallelujah. And the waves and the winds were blowing. A natural thing here, the picture is. And they were so afraid because the waves were so high. And that ship was filling with water. But Jesus was somewhere lying, resting. And they called Jesus and said, "Don't you care if we perish?" That's the way you feel when you're in the midst of trauma. Where are you? I need you now. I need you now. Where are you? But Jesus, because of who he is, because he's a Prince of Peace, he simply got up and he spoke to the wind. He spoke to the waves. And suddenly there was calm. I imagine the disciples saw that and they said, "Oh my God, who is this man that he can speak to nature, that he has the power to calm the storms on the sea?" So now you can just imagine, and if you really think about it, you will. When you get in the midst of a storm, if there's a relationship with God, he will speak to you. Peace in your mind. Oh yeah, I know you said you're making that sound easy, Sister Pryor. You make it sound just like that's all you got to do. Just a little bit of something. That's all it takes. When you're hurting. When the grief is so intense. You make it sound like that's easy. But it's never easy. It's not meant to be easy. Never. Rick Warren, who wrote Purpose Driven Life, said this about pain. He said, "Pain helps to develop you. There's always a purpose for pain. You may not see it while you're in your trauma, but there is a purpose in pain." Jesus stated also in St. John, the 14th chapter, and the 27th verse, here's what he spoke. "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you." Notice. "My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives." It's not like what the world gives. "Don't let your heart be troubled or fearful." Those are words from the Lord. But in this particular passage, Jesus was talking about the Holy Ghost. He was talking about the Holy Spirit that would lead us and it would guide us and give us peace. That's the reason why you need the Holy Ghost, saints. That's why we tell you to be filled with the Spirit. You're going to need it for your trauma experiences. You're going to need the peace of God. You're going to need the Spirit of the Lord to live inside of you. What is peace? Peace is wholeness. It's inner tranquility. For those people who follow Christ, that's what he gives you, peace. It's hope. It's satisfaction. It's trust. It's a gentle quietness in the mind and spirit, no matter what is going on externally. It's a state of harmony. Have you ever wondered why some people seem to go through life so easy? Seem not to cry about everything when they get a bad report and feel like throwing in the towel? Seem to want to pull the hair out of their head. Have you ever noticed why? What are they doing? Are they in denial? What's going on? But when there is a relationship with God, hallelujah, you'll shed some tears, hallelujah, but you're not going to go crazy, hallelujah. You are hurt, but you keep hanging on in there because you know in whom you have believed. Jesus promised us peace, and it was all because if we can believe the finished work of Christ on the cross and saw what he went through. My God, you're talking about trauma? We don't really know anything about trauma. The Bible says he was beaten beyond recognition. They led him like a sheep to the slaughter, but he opened not his mouth. Didn't say a word. Yeah. Was he grieved? I'm sure he was. But he had peace. He had peace. He was a prince of peace. For the word of the Lord says in Isaiah 26:3, thou wilt keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on me. But now here's the key. We must accept this peace so that it will work for us. When someone gives you a gift, you must accept it in order to use it for an intended person. Otherwise, it's of no value to you. And that's the way it is with peace. You must use it by trusting in God no matter what. You say no matter what because you're trusting in God. You don't have to understand it because you trust your mighty God because of that relationship. And then when you do that, you can have assurance that you've done your part. Now it's up to God. Peace is that quality that money cannot buy. Worldly possessions alone cannot bring you peace. Titles and positions, oh my God. Fine cars and beautiful homes won't give you peace. You've heard the saying, no peace, no God, no peace. No God, no peace. Let me, briefly, I said, no God, no peace. The N-O God, no. If you don't know God, you can't have peace if you don't really know God. There are too many distractions, too many disturbances around us. You can't have peace in a pandemic if you don't know God. Not true peace, not real peace. Not when people are calling you on the phone and telling you, you know your cousin died. They're in the hospital on a respirator. You know your child, he got hurt on the football field and he's at the hospital. He was in a terrible accident. She committed suicide. That's N-O peace because you don't have relationship with God. But the K-N-O-W, my. The K-N-O-W means that you have a relationship with God because you spent time with him. You've learned to trust him. You've learned to depend upon him. That's when you can have peace. No peace, K-N-O-W. K-N-O-W, no God, no peace. Peace is the state of harmony that is available to believers through having a right relationship, I said. And it's especially associated with the Holy Spirit. Can't leave the Holy Spirit out. No. There's no way you can leave the Holy Spirit out. That's why we tell people, you need the Holy Spirit. It's not because we don't have anything else to teach. But we know how powerful it is. We know what the Holy Spirit would do. Yes! Jesus was my Jehovah Shalom. That's what he was to me. He was the Lord, my peace. And it was the peace of God through all my trauma that brought me through, not out of it. He didn't deliver me out of it, but he brought me through the storm. And I want to remind you today that when you get in adverse and difficult situations, when trials are so heavy that you can't bear them, hallelujah, hallelujah, you've got to ask God for peace. You know why? Because he is the Prince of Peace, according to Isaiah 9 and 6. Just bear with me for a few more minutes. I know we're going to do communion here in a few minutes, but I want to tell you something. If you're going to have peace through your trauma, you're going to have to separate yourself from the lies of the enemy. Separate the lies from the truth. When you face adversities, we often let our minds wander to the worst case scenario. We entertain our fears and let them rule our heart. Satan's tricks are to lie about the meaning of the present situation in order to get you to forget the truth. This is the time you must intentionally pursue peace. It's warfare. What's our theme for this season we're in now? Warfare. That's what Pastor said. This is warfare. It's good versus evil. So we're going to have to fight. I remember I had to fight. If I was going to survive my trauma, I was going to have to fight. The devil came to my mind and he told me, he said, you got two cars and they're not paid for. You can't take care of two cars by yourself. You're retired. He told me, you got a house note. Had just built a house 11 years before Bishop transitioned. You got a big house note. And he said, and what you going to do? Who's going to be there for you when you get sick? You're living alone. You're not going to be able to make it. That's what he fed to my mind. There's going to be nobody there to take care of you. So you can't listen to the voice of the enemy. That's why you've got to be filled with the Spirit. And Pastor told us that there are three people and three things we need in our lives when we're going through trauma. Did he not? And the one that I really, 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 really remember and I thought about today is that you've got to have a mentor. You've got to have someone in your life who that can encourage you. When the devil was trying to make me think I'm not going to make it, he said, oh, that Social Security is not going to take care of you. Oh, that's what he told me. And you're going to spend up all your money, little money you got in the bank, trying to pay your bills. We didn't have tons, but we had enough. I didn't want to spend all my bills my money at one time because I wanted to keep living. I wanted to keep doing some things. So he told me, this is what he told me. You can't do that. You can't do this. He fed me lies. But thank God for my spiritual mentor who prophetically spoke into my life and told me provisions have already been made. My God. I was trying to figure it out. I got this. I have this. I have that. I have that. Where am I going to do? How am I going to do this? Where am I going to do this? I don't know how to do this. I don't know how to do that. And my spiritual mentor spoke and said, provisions have already been made. I had to learn to trust them and to believe them. Hallelujah. Because every day when I went to the mailbox or whenever I went to the mailbox, there was a notice in there, maybe, or an email letting me know that I had some kind of responsibility that needed to be taken care of. So did I choose to just focus in on my responsibilities, or should I focus in on provisions have already been made? My God. It enabled me to be able to sleep and to rest at night. Hallelujah. And so I thank God, you need to make sure that you've got something to counteract the lies of the devils. He told me that I wouldn't make it, but I remember the word of the Lord that said that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Get rid of the negative lies. Get rid of the negative lies. You've got to think positive thoughts. You have got to speak positive thoughts. I always say, get you a God said. You've heard me say it so many times. I mean that thing. When you're going through trauma, you have got to get a God said. What did God say? He said, yea, though you walk through the valley of the shadow of death. That's a dark valley. The shadow of death. What did he say? He says, I'm with you. Great consolation. That's Psalms 23 and 4. You've got to get the word. And because sometimes we're so experienced in life, we need a guide. You need someone to guide you. You need someone to be with you. I'm with you. His presence. We need the presence of the Lord every day. I pray, Lord, every day, surround me with your presence. Hallelujah. Because I know in the presence of the Lord, there's fullness of joy and that I can make it. If I believe his word, if I apply his word, somebody shout with me, I am with you. Shout it. Shout it. Shout it. Shout it. Let the devil know God's with you. Hallelujah. You're the righteousness of God. Shout, I am. I'm with you. I'm with you. I'm with you, and because of that, I've got the favor of God. That's all you need is a favor. When you get the favor of God, can't no devil in hell cause you to put a gun to your head and blow your brains out. Hallelujah. I've got the favor of God. I've got his favor. That's a promise to me. Then the word of the Lord says in Psalms 119 and 49, put me in remembrance of my word. Hallelujah. It doesn't mean that God has forgotten, but he says, remind me. Remind me of what I told you. What did I say? What did I say, Kwame? Did I say I was going to be with you? Hallelujah. Do you remember what I said? I told you that I was going to be with you. So sometimes you just got to walk through your house saying, God's with me. Sometimes, many days, I just come out of my bedroom. That's really my prayer closet. I come out of my bedroom and I just walk through my kitchen, go through the dining room, the family room, and the living room, and I let the presence of the Lord be with me. And I am God's with me. God's with me. And then with my wonderful young self, I just climb up the steps, go in the bedrooms upstairs, go in the bathroom, even go in the closet. And I said, God's with me. Sometimes you got to talk to yourself. I know people said you shouldn't talk to yourself, but I talk to myself. Let the devil know you're having your own private staff meeting. You're talking to yourself. Hallelujah. You're not crazy. Making those confessions about the goodness of God. He's a good God. That's why God's word is so vital to our existence. You got to read it. You have to study it. You got to live by it. He says in Psalms 119 and 105, God's word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. A lamp. A lamp. A lamp illuminates. It's wisdom. Spiritual wisdom is what we need. Not necessarily a lamp that you have in your house, that beautiful lamp that's sitting on, but a lamp, the word of God, it's a light. It illuminates your way so you won't stumble and fall, so you can see where you're going. A light to your path. That's what you need. You need guidance. You need you need to see where you're going. You need to know. If you don't know where you're going, you may just walk off over into a hole. My grandson was driving me to church today. Thank the Lord for good grandchildren. Glory, hallelujah. provisions have been made. As we were driving, there, you know, I thank God for our governor who's trying to fix roads and bridges and all of that, and we had a detour. And as he was driving me today, he saw the holes. He saw the potholes. I call them canyons. He saw the potholes. And so he was able, because of light, he was able to swing around the hole because of wisdom. He knew not to run Nana's car over in the hole. That's why you need a lamp and you need a light in your life. A way so that when you don't know what to do, you need direction. When you need directions, God is there. When all of these obstructions are in your way, you need to let God be your light. Cling to his promises. And then the next thing, and I'm almost through, you want to surrender control to the one who controls it all. Stop trying to make sense of everything. Turn it over to Jesus and let him work it out. You all remember the song? Turn it over to Jesus and he'll work it out. Best attorney you can ever have. I'm a living witness to that. He's the best attorney you can have. Stop saying, I wonder what if. Spend all your time. I wonder why. Well, it seems like to me. But if it was me, we spent all of our time trying to figure it out for ourselves, trying to make sense. But if you would just turn it over to Jesus and let him work it out, he will do it for you. I know sometimes we want to question some things, but if you spend all of your time trying to question and figure it out, did I understand why my husband came home laughing and talking? And then the next minute, gone? I don't even understand it today. But I trust God. Mm-hmm. I trust that he knows what's best for me. So through my trauma and through my past, through, notice I said through. I didn't say, you can't stop in the middle. You want peace through the trauma because it's building something in you. It's teaching you how to have compassion for others. You know, people who never go through anything, they always have the answer. They always tell you what not to do. They haven't been through diddly squat, and then they won't tell you what to do. Never had a storm, never had a problem, really. Oh, just let them keep on living. Hallelujah. Have you ever watched me? Just let them keep on living. But you've got to turn everything over to Jesus and allow him to work it out. The thing that amazes me about this is Bible scholars said that Paul wrote many of his letters from prison. You figure that out. Doing the right thing, loving the Lord. People say, I thought she was a Christian. What happened to her? How did it happen? They must not be living right. I thought they loved the Lord. If they love, they talking about God's a good God. If he's so good, why did it happen to them? But Paul was in prison unjustly. He was trying to help people. And the religious leaders of that day did not like him because their minds was all on earthly things, worldly pursuits. And they felt that if Paul could convince these Gentiles and some of these people to be saved, that they would take from them in prison, beaten, cold, dark prison. I had the opportunity to go to Rome, and we went into, they showed us one of the prisons, the dungeons that Paul was put in. Oh my God. How do you live? How do you live in a prison like that? How do you live in a dungeon like that? You have to have the peace of God. He knew why he was there. And so Paul encouraged the believers. Here's what it is. He encouraged the Philippian church to receive this peace through prayer. David said in Psalm 55 and 17, evening, morning, and noon will I pray and cry aloud, and he shall hear me. Look at that. In the evening, in the morning, at night will I cry aloud. Some of us won't even pray up in between that. He said, but if you're going to have peace with God, you've got to develop a prayer life. You can't wait for everybody to pray you to peace. You've got to have your own peace. Get your own prayer life. Pray. Call upon him. David said, I cried loud. Sometimes things can be so tough and so intense, Deacon Bell, that you've got to cry loud. No time for just a little dab of douya and a little patty cake and just a little bit of prayer, a two-minute prayer, and get on your knees and hop right back up. Sometimes you got to stay down there, and you got to learn how to call Jesus. Hallelujah, call on him. Is he deaf? No, he's not. But this thing is so intense. I need you. I want you to know that I'm desperate for you. I need you, and I need you now. And then once you cry out to the Lord, once you cry out to the Lord, many times he will answer your prayer. It says in Philippians 4, 6 through 7, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything with prayer and supplication, you come to him humbly and plead your case. With thanksgiving, that's a problem. Some people have no gratitude. I don't care how much you do for them. They come to you and ask you for something, and you do it. They don't even have the audacity to say thank you. Mm-hmm. Many times we can't receive breakthroughs because we don't know how to say thank you. We live in a society where entitlement is everything. Sometimes our children, the more we do for them, the less they say thank you. You know, I really thank God for my pastor. I really do, and I'm just saying this, and I'm not, you know, trying to build him up. I have two granddaughters, and I love them. They are not around me as much as they were when they were younger. But because Carrington and Chandler are in Saginaw, and we see each other often, anything Nana does for them, the first thing they say is, thank you, Nana. If I go to the football game, I was there the other day, Lord Jesus. I was at the soccer game. Oh, my God. It was hot. We stayed so through practice till the game, and then I got cold, Kwame, between hot and cold. But when they finished, the number one thing they said is, thank you, Nana, for coming to my game. I love that about them. They don't feel that it's just my risk. I didn't have to go. Carrington drove there, and I drove Chandler. But they said, thank you. We need to teach our children, parents, to be thankful. It's not going to come by osmosis. It's not just going to jump on them. You teach them that when someone does something for them, you say thanks. And you got to have a heart of thanksgiving. That's what the scripture says. With a heart of thanksgiving, you need a heart of thanksgiving, and God will bless you. And then what we need to do is meditate on scripture daily. Confess this scripture. Keep your mind clear of it. Worry and stress. We sit and watch crazy stuff all day, stupid stuff, and read, you know, and then we think we're going to have a stress-free life. It won't happen. You got to think some positive thoughts. Stop sitting around thinking about death and dying all the time. And who died? I've received so many people. In the last two or three years, I know so many who have died, and I was calling. Looked like every time somebody died, I was calling somebody, tell me, you know so-and-so died. Did you hear that so-and-so died? And they were calling me. Last night I got a call. Day before I got a call. Somebody that I know that was really close. I certainly want you to pray for the Granderson family. Superintendent Derek Granderson, pastor in Minnesota. His daughter died, 26 years old the other day. He's from Saginaw. Comes by this church often. His daughter died suddenly. Devastating trauma. But we've got to learn to speak positive. Think about the good things that have happened to you. Because I believe that God's word is a weapon. Isaiah 52, 54:2 says, for thy maker is thy husband. That's what I remember. That's a scripture I remember. The Bible said, the word of the Lord said to me, your maker is your husband. And so he'll protect you. He will cover you. He'll watch over you because he promised to do so. He'll provide for you if you allow him so. And then Psalms 119 and 165 says, great peace, not a little bit. Great peace have they which love thy law. Because I love the word of the Lord, I can have great peace. You can't just like his word. You've got to love it. When you love something, hallelujah, you'll spend time with it, won't you? Great peace, he says, great peace. That's more than just a little bit. Great peace have they which love thy law. And then you won't stumble. You won't have any problems because you love his word. In the morning, at noonday, during the day, you'll take time reading the word of the Lord. And then here's my last point. You need to listen to worship music. I said worship music. Bask in worship music. Listen to songs that make sense. Don't get no crazy. You know, the person might have been inspired to write it, but some of the stuff don't make no kind of sense. I was listening to Sirius the other day, driving down the street, and my car was just vibrating. I wasn't rocking it, but it was just, the bass was so heavy. And I know in this day and time, son, I love you. You're a wonderful bass player because you don't play over all the other instruments. You believe in harmony and blending. But the music to this song was bound to add my car. I got a kind of big car. I don't know what it weighs, but it's got a big car, and it was bouncing. Just, you know, act like it was rocking with the music. It was so loud. Some songs don't edify. Some music don't edify. You need to listen to music that will edify and build you up and cause a calmness. You know, when you go to the spa and you get in that little room, they got you in there and you laying on the bed, they got music that soothes you. That music is so pleasant. A lot of harmony in it. It's so pleasant. That's when it's time to get up. I got a massage the other day. The music was so beautiful and so calming. She said, Mrs. Pryor, I'm finished. I said, well, call the police because I'm not getting up. I mean, that music and that massage that she gave me felt so good. So you want music that will bless you, that will edify you. You know, I like the praise team when they sang today. I love when they opened up with their music. The word spoke to my spirit. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Just think about that. You're not bouncing around. You are a waymaker, promise keeper. Light in the darkness. That is who you are. Oh, waymaker, miracle worker,
promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who.
Ephesians, just keep on, baby, softly. Ephesians 5 and 19 says, speaking to yourselves in songs and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melodies in your heart to the Lord.
That is who you are.
Who you are, who you are. Oh, oh, you're my miracle.
Darkness, my God, that is who you are.
That's why I can lay down at night and not toss it and turn it, because I've got peace in my mind.
Light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
I want to close with this. I remember some years ago when I first got into church, the old saints, we had testimony service. And we would testify to how we felt and what God had done for us. I'll never forget this song. I sing it sometimes when I wake up in the morning. Oh, I woke up this morning with my mind. Yeah.
Stay on Jesus.
Come on, stand up. I
woke up this morning with my mind.
Stay
on the Lord.
Hey, I woke up
this morning with my mind.
And through every trial, that we will not allow this pandemic to drive us crazy, but we will look to the hills from which cometh our help, knowing that all of our help comes from the Lord. Until we love you and we praise you, and we give you glory. I don't know if there's someone out there today who's experiencing some kind of trauma, and it's deep, it's heavy. But you would like to have peace. Yes. Peace so that when you lay down at night, you can sleep. Peace so that you won't be fearful. Yes. Some people live in fear. That's trauma. Some people are stressed all the time. That's trauma. If you're there today and you want to know how to have peace, I give you Jesus. I offer you Jesus. I offer to you Jesus. He's the one to give that peace. You don't have to be ashamed. I don't want nobody to know I'm struggling. I don't want anyone to know that I'm hurting. Hallelujah. But if you're going to be healed, if you're going to build some resistance, you're going to have to turn it over to Jesus. and let him work it out. Anyone there? We'll pray for you if you just raise your hand. You need prayer? Just raise your hand. Hallelujah. Whatever the Lord says is peace. Peace, Jesus. Oh, peace. Ooh. Whatever the Lord said to me. Hey, somebody just go get near her. The hand raised. Peace. One of the prayer warriors.
Peace.
I need peace, Lord.
Peace, Lord.
Peace. The peace of God.
Forth, God. We thank you for her transparency, Father. Yes. We thank you, God, even now, Father, in the name of Jesus, that we have peace through trauma, Father. God, pour back into her, oh God, what she poured out on today, Father. Continue to bless her, continue to keep her, God, in the center of your will. We thank you for using her mightily even on today, God. We give you praise, honor, and glory in Jesus' name. We praise the name of the Lord. If you heard that sermon where Evangelist Pryor said, no peace, no God, no peace. And then she said, no God, K-N-O-W, no peace. I want to encourage anybody on today who has not accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, now's the time. You may have backslidden and fell away from the Lord, but now is the time for you to get saved. Amen. Now is the time, right now. All you have to do is confess with your mouth and believe in your heart the Lord Jesus and that God raised him from the dead. The Bible says you shall be saved. And so we're going to pray the prayer of salvation on today. If that's you and you need to be saved, I want you to repeat after me. Lord Jesus, I believe that you died on the cross and God raised you from the dead. I ask you to come into my heart. Be my Lord. Be my Savior. I know that I'm a sinner and I know that I need to be saved. So save me on today, Lord. I give you my life for you to lead and guide me. We ask these blessings in your son Jesus' name. Thank God. Amen. Let's give God some praise one more time. Hallelujah. Well, at this time, Elder Edward Jones is going to come. He's going to lead us in communion.
Thank God for peace. God bless you, Evangelist Pryor. I enjoy that word. Amen. Real peace is through Jesus Christ. They sit at the peace table without the peacemaker, and the world remains in trouble. But whatever happening in your life today, you can have peace. Amen. Eighth month of the year, first Sunday, and we have the opportunity to have Holy Communion made possible through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the final sacrifice for all sin. John was baptizing by the river one day, and he looked up and saw Jesus, and he said, Behold, the Lamb of God that taketh away the sins of the world. We don't have to put any more lambs, no more sheep, goats. But he is the ultimate sacrifice. And he took his disciples away and talked to them. And as he faced Calvary, he began to explain to him the great sacrifice. But he also let us know that as often as we do this, we show forth his death and suffering. We become partakers. And today we're going to do the commemoration of our Lord and Savior, his appreciation of what he has done for us at Calvary. Amen.
Amen.
He took the bread and broke it and gave it to his disciples. Stand, please. Before that, he prayed over it. Father God, we thank you for these bread, the assimilation of your body that was broken for us. Oh God, because of your wounds, because of the brokenness of your body, we now can experience the great salvation. After praying over it, he gave it to his disciples and told them to eat. For this is my body that has been broken for you. Then he took and poured the wine. And he had prayed over it.
I know it was the blood for me.
He poured it and he told them to take, for this is my blood that has been shed for you. Drink ye all of it.
I know it was the blood for me. I know it was the blood.
Oh, yes.
I know it was the blood. I know it was the blood for me. Blood for me.
of the blood. Amen. Jesus said, one of you shall betray me. The disciples looked and said, is it I? Is it I? We're reminded that every time we take the sacrament and we go back to life as usual, it's like crucifying the Lord all over again. And we're saying, is it I? You should make up in your mind that every time I do this, it's going to make me better for it. Amen. It said that Jesus led his disciples out, and he began to sing a hymn. One of my favorites is Amazing Grace, as we prepare to go. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a hands. Father God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your word that come to let us know that there is peace. Oh God, that surpass all understanding. For those troubled minds, for those that are perplexed, even now, let your peace come. Give them to know that you're standing close by. Oh God, and you will not forsake us. We ask your prayers to be, we ask that our prayers before our speaker on today, strengthen the Lord for her giving of herself as she had poured out to speak your word. Bless your people, one and all. In the mighty name of Jesus, thank God. Amen. We have asked prayer for Deacon Nash in the house, prayer for missionary Holloman and family. Amen. And all that are sick and afflicted. Yes. Father God of heaven, even now, all things are in your hand. Lord, you know, even while we're facing all kinds of situations, we know not what the outcome is. Father, we know that you're in control. In spite of how it looks, how it seems, you've given to us the power and the authority to bind the works of the enemy. Satan, the blood of Jesus is against you. Even now, Lord, according to your will, we ask that you cover this in the name of Jesus, this situation, this circumstances in your control now in the name of Jesus. Touch, heal, and deliver. Let your peace come, the peace that has been spoken this day. Peace to the mind, peace to the spirit. Oh God, comfort and strengthen that family even in this hour. And as you do these things, we'll take no credit to ourselves, but the honor and the glory is thine. In Jesus' name, amen.
All kinds of diseases People are slipping away. The economy's down. Just can't be. Muggers and robbers, no place seems to